Can you all hear me? Can you all hear me, ladies and gentlemen? Thank you very much. Just before we begin formally, can I draw your attention to the slides of housekeeping information that are going round on here? Please pay attention and read them. They tell you important things like what to do if fire breaks out and where the loos are and stuff like that. So we'll just let them go around once more before we start. Right, thank you very much. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's my great pleasure to welcome you here to the Geological Society to this first Strix lecture. Two important things from those housekeeping notes. First, remove these things from your pocket and do what I'm doing and turn it off or silent. Second, if there is a fire and you can't remember the instructions, follow me. Right, well, it's a great pleasure to see so many of you here to this first Strix lecture, which has been generously sponsored by Google, and that's why we have been able to offer this free. Before we get down to the formal part of the meeting, I'd just like to invite David Harper of Google to say a few words.
Thanks very much. So, for those of you who don't know, my name's David Harper. I'm the head of university relations in Europe, the Middle East, and Africa for Google. But I'm also a proud member of the information retrieval community. Google's delighted to be sponsoring this award series, an award in memory of a really great practitioner, information retrieval practitioner, Tony Kent. And it's pretty clear why we'd be interested in sponsoring this particular award, because Google Search, of course, is predicated and based on the research of information retrieval practitioners and researchers. So again, we are delighted to be associated with this particular award and in particular sponsoring this series of lectures. I want to say one final thing, and that is that I'm even more delighted that the first lecture in the series is being given by Sue Dumay. Because Sue and I go back a long way, and she and I are great friends, and we've also worked together quite closely as part of the SIGIR, ACM SIGIR community. So again, very proud and very happy to be associated with this series. Thanks very much.
Thank you, David. I just remind you, you have all had the programme, but what's happening today is that I'm just going to say a little bit of background for a few minutes about Tony Kent, and then I'm going to hand over to Jan Wiley to talk about some of the work that he and Tony did together. Then we'll have tea, which is in the lower library, just the room more or less opposite through there, and then we have Susan's lecture. Right. This meeting is all about one man, or it all stems from one man, and that man is Tony Kent, quite a remarkable man who died in 1997. His working life divides itself rather neatly into three phases, punctuated by two major life-changing decisions. He was always interested in nature, especially birds, and we'll come back to that in a moment. So it seemed quite natural that he became a zoologist and did a degree and a PhD in zoology and ended up as a lecturer in zoology at the University of Nottingham. He actually lived just outside Nottingham in a little village called Attenborough, where there is a nature reserve, the Attenborough Nature Reserve, more or less at the bottom of his garden, so he could go out of his garden through a gate into the nature reserve and do research on birds and so on. He accumulated quite a lot of data as a result of his research, which he thought he ought to have a better way of handling, and he decided he would use a computer. The university had a computer. He was entitled to use it, so he thought, I'll use the computer to handle my information, to store and retrieve it. He looked for some software that would do what he wanted, couldn't find any. That's where his entrepreneurial spirit kicked in. He sat down, taught himself programming, and wrote himself some software to do what he wanted. That was quite early in the history of using computers for information retrieval, and so, lo and behold, he was an instant expert. At the same time, the Royal Society of Chemistry, or then its predecessor, the Chemical Society, was getting interested in using computers for information retrieval, and they set up a little research unit at Nottingham. And I'm delighted to see two of my colleagues from those days with us, Barry Wyatt and Ash Carby. They were going to set up this research unit, and they set it up with an advisory committee. Tony was an expert in information retrieval and using computers, so he got invited to join the advisory committee. Then came the first of the major decision points. I remember him telling me, quite out of the blue, he got a phone call from the Vice-Chancellor of the university, who was a man called Fred Dainton, later Lord Dainton, a chemist, saying, you know this unit that the RSC is setting up and you're on the advisory committee? They want somebody to run it full time. Will you do it? And this meant giving up his job as a lecturer in zoology. But he swallowed hard and thought about it and said yes. So that then moved him into the second phase of his career, where he was working with the Chemical Society, which later became the Royal Society of Chemistry, on using computers for chemical information. He wrote a software package to search the chemical abstracts tapes and provide a service. And that little unit evolved into a thing some of you may have come across called UKIS, UKCIS, the UK Chemical Information Service. And it moved from being purely research to start charging for its services. It then became inappropriate for it to remain as part of the university, so it moved into the Chemical Society. And over a period of years, it grew from an initial 5 people to 10, 12, 15, 20. Eventually, it assumed some of the other information activities that went on in the Royal Society of Chemistry, book publishing, journal publishing, the library, one or two administrative functions, and Tony proved himself a very able administrator, a very able entrepreneur, and a good people manager. And in the end, he found himself looking after something like 300 people and a turnover of several million pounds a year. Now, the senior man at the Royal Society of Chemistry bore the title at that time of the General Secretary. A man called John Ruck Keane, who'd been there for many, many years, and he was coming up to retirement. He actually only died last year at the age of, I think, 94. So he was coming up to retirement, and there appeared to be an expectation that Tony would be the logical successor for him. I never actually heard officially that he was offered the job, but I think he probably was. And he had to sit down and think, is that really what he wanted to do? Did he really want to be... it would be a very prestigious position, but it would also be a lot of administration and a fair amount of politicking, because the RSC, like all these learned societies, is run by a whole lot of boards and committees staffed by professors of chemistry and that sort of thing. Did he really want to do that? In the end, in 1980, he decided no, he didn't. So he left. And he then started to work with some other colleagues, principally a man called Derek Barlow, who was his equivalent in what used to be the Institute of Electrical Engineers, I think it's called something else now, and Jan, who we'll come to in a moment. So that was the end of his second phase and moved him into the third phase that Jan is going to talk about. Just before he does that, I'll just give a little background to the Strix Award. When Tony died in 1997, and a group of us who knew him wanted to do something in his memory, and we set up this award, Tony had used ornithological terms for his software, including the major one, the Strix package, which Jan is going to talk about. So we adopted the Strix as the motif for the award. The Strix is a genus of owls, and so there is the Strix Award, and we'll let the owl watch what goes on from here on. That's actually, I believe, a tawny owl, Strix aluco. So that's just a very brief background to Tony Kent and the Strix Award. And that's now my cue to shut up and hand over to Jan, who's going to talk about the third phase of Tony's work and some of the things that went on there.
Well, this very event testifies to the pioneering work that Tony did before I met him. Just one other thing, a little detail to add to what we've just heard is that Jenny Kent, who was to become his wife, she was working with him on the computer was one of the original Leo Lyons electronic office, and they were programming together in machine code, and so when I met Tony, it was after a couple of years after he had bailed out of the great job that he could have had, and he bailed out. It was a very brave thing to do because he had an idea for a text database, we'll get to that, and you know, it was just him and Jenny, and I met him in 1985. It was, I was actually looking for computer-aided retrieval of microfiche because my job was the analysis of hundreds and thousands of newspaper articles, and I thought it would be a jolly useful thing to get computers involved and microfiche and everything, save a lot of work. And so there was a little tiny ad in the Times, and computer-aided microfiche, Imtech, which was one of the scores of little companies then beginning to manufacture various sorts of Unix boxes. And I phoned up, and the salesman couldn't make head nor tail of what I was talking about. And so he said he very generously gave me Tony's number. And I phoned him up and invited him to lunch. And 2 weeks later, we had lunch in Chimes, which was just starting as a... And I tried to explain to him what I was on about, and he tried to explain to me what Strix was on about, and there was, I must say, two or three ciders and a great deal of beard pulling, because Tony, I don't know if you remember, when he was thinking hard, he used to pull his beard, and beginning to be a fair amount of teasing about whether or not I was crazy, so the next thing that happened was that I was, after that, we decided to meet again, and I was invited up to his farmhouse in outside of Nottingham, Newark. And it was the middle of winter. It wasn't furnished. It was very, very cold. And we sat in front of a log fire and ate off the ground. And then next morning, that was my sort of moment of revelation. We went out into an even colder office, and there was this Imtech box, and on it was version 2.1 of Strix. And that's when I, as a, you know, I didn't know about Boolean operators. I didn't know about free text retrieval, and suddenly there was this whole world that was being introduced to me. And that, you know, yes, Boolean operators are what we use all the time. Every time we go shopping, every time we make any kind of food, it's and or not this, maybe we should have this, etc. And so that filled me with huge excitement. So then what happened was that we decided to carry on the relationship. And he had a job in London once a week, two-day job once a week. And this Imtech box was about that big. And it was not even a luggable. But somehow, he managed to lug that computer on the train down to London once a week, because we only had the one computer. And I remember I used to meet him at Warren Street Underground, and the computer would change hands, and I'd take it away for the day, work on Strix and try and learn, you know, what could be done with it. And then he'd stay overnight with me, and we'd talk about what I'd learned and ideas of the future and all that kind of thing. And that went on for about 18 months. So I learned a hell of a lot. And then this is the picture of me looking a bit younger, and Tony, one of the high points, Jenny, who he'd been working with in 1967, finally became his wife in 1987. And I was great, great privilege of being the best man at his wedding. So I've had a little bit of fun here with, you know, where the title is about Boolean algebra, so I'm making a bit of a story. And so what the essence of Strix was that it was a database. This was Tony's vision, was that it was a database that used all the powers that could be mustered then of information retrieval, free text. But the key is a database, and the database is something that is structured and built. It's not like information retrieval where you've got a mass of information you're trying to make sense of, trying to get something back from. It's a database, so you start at the beginning. And we combined things because we came from different worlds. I mean, the world of databases and the world of information retrieval at the time, completely separate. And I think they still probably are pretty separate. But Strix combined them both. And so then I came along because my work dealt with, for years and years, faceted taxonomies. And so although Tony was, you know, free text retrieval, he was fascinated by what you could do with faceted taxonomies. We called them multivariate classification schemas. And so that was another and, that we put something together. And then the other thing that still isn't really being done, I don't think, is the combination of pre-coordinate processing, which is you get an article or an item and you classify it before it goes in. And it's a little extra time, but you make a lot of advantage at the other end of the process. But then we combine that with the post-coordinate, which Strix was massively good at. Again, we had something new. Together, we were both into providing people with full functionality, but at a price that people could afford. Tony's vision was very much bring it to the people. And, you know, it had to be affordable. And in those days, affordable was something like £360 for an MS-DOS system. It became cheaper. And I remember persuading him to do a mini Strix at £65, which was, and so we worked on all these things for, I guess, a couple of years, and then we decided to. I had a company called Trend Monitor, and Microbell was the company that Tony had, and we. It was a good way of working together, and I think I recommend it, is that we both went on each other's boards, and we exchange 10% of each other's companies. Not too close, and yet very close. So those are the ands. We've got some ors. We were looking at a very big market, because my idea was to use database publishing something that you could publish, that you could only publish because you had the information in a database, because you'd added value to it that way. And he had the whole gamut of information management tools and that kind of application. Strix had the Boolean chop, the alphabetical list, but it also had numeric capabilities, which was totally new at the time. Integer validated fields that records could be added, very simple, added, subtracted, average, those kinds of things, but a showing that a movement in that direction. And the other thing that Tony sets, and set searching, building of sets, I believe is the way that, you know, a proper inquiry into, you can't know what to search for all at once. So you build a set, you save the set, other sets, combine sets, and then you get to the conclusion. And what Tony did, which was, he cared desperately that it could be usable by ordinary people, and he kept that process very simple. And I'll show you it in a minute. And yeah, we wanted to have both professional and amateurs being able to use it. He was very much into, as I say, it should be a power tool for people. He was absolutely obsessed with processor efficiency and speed. Those were the things that really gave him a buzz, is processor efficiency. Strix was very similar. He was inspired by a program that I'm sure a lot of you know called BASIS. And Strix did about 90% of what BASIS did. But it did it in 256K to begin with. And that shows, you know, how demanding his own standards were. Speed of retrieval, what really excited him was to get that search file going made up, maybe 2 seconds quicker, making it go faster. We'll get a little bit to it. He always started with practical utility, always started with user needs. He was not a great fan of the academic science of information. I've got a little quote coming on that. We were both very much into using these tools to enhance people's ability to use computers, not to have an external artificial intelligence make it easy for them. He believed, and I have some quotes saying, is that people, in order to access information intelligently, need to use their mind. And that's what the unfortunate thing, in a way, was that we were both, I guess this is an and, but you know, we were both into development and new ideas and all the excitement, but neither of us were very good at or very interested in marketing. So, but Strix did, we did manage to sell about 450 copies at about £350 each. So that's a market, a small one compared with Google, but it's a start. And we were both very much passionate not to work for people, working for ourselves at home. This is a bit of fun. It's, you know, I always wonder what the use of XOR is really. I'm sure there's a use for it, but this is a use for it. We were both, you know, he was born in Singapore, I was born in Accra. I'd never been to Singapore, he'd never been to Accra. But there was something that was fun and an and about that, is that it meant that we were both colonials. We were not part of the sort of British establishment. And, you know, he used to tease me, mercilessly. I'm a Canadian, and, you know, being the colonial. I knew about Canadian history. His actual thesis in biology was on the color change in minnows. That was what, you know. We'll go through that. I spoke French, and his first language was Chinese, because in Singapore, his Aya, his nurse, was Chinese. I always wondered whether that might have done something to his mind, and something rather good. So here we are. Microbell was Tony's company, which I ended up 10% I had. Strix is a product. The outside there is the box. That's Nipper sitting on the manual that I wrote. And on the screen up there is an actual running copy of Strix running in an old version of Windows 98 in a DOS box. Here's the manual. One of the things about Tony and Microbell as a company is he was absolutely devoted to customers. That was his priority. What customers wanted and looking after customers. And he used to travel hundreds of miles all over the country fixing things for customers, talking to them on the phone, always being in good humor. He always called, you know, he always called his customers idiots. He always said that, you know, computer users are experts and very intelligent in their own field, but when it comes to computers, they're idiots, and you've got to treat them as idiots and, you know, help them as much as possible. So that was our brochure. I didn't do this brochure because I always said that one. We had an agent called John Crowther who did this, and I always said this is too complex, too busy, nobody's going to read it. But it is worth reading, and you know, it has all the detail there, but not as a brochure. Here we have, I presume you can read them, this gives an idea of the kinds of areas which we sold into. And it's not a bad list, and there was a lot more. And that's despite not really very much being spent on marketing, not really very much at all. So we got to that. Here's something that, just one example is Interpol. We had Interpol. And I just want to read what Interpol said. We got it into Interpol, and I quote, "The Bureau says that so far as, the Bureau says that so far it has realized a 20 to 30 fold increase in efficiency with this system. It has cut paperwork, duplication, and a lot of legwork, and numerous tasks have been restructured and assigned to civilian personnel without losing police expertise and accountability." There's stuff. And then it also, Interpol also said, "Although search commands in Strix are based on Boolean logic, the Bureau reports that the learning period for inexperienced operators is quite short. After a couple of hours of training, most new operators could initiate basic searches without help. A mark of the system's success, the Bureau says, is that staff now prefer to work on other inquiries until a terminal," because it was all time-sharing then, "until the terminal became free so that they could use Strix rather than go back to the old methods." Now, on the basis of that, we put in an app. There was a tender then for the system, the police system, which became Holmes. And Holmes had a very, very sticky beginning, and I think it's still pretty sticky. And it cost many, many millions, and God knows how much was wasted. Well, we did put into that, and we got, I don't know, up to the, whatever, the two or three stages in. And then we were quoting 300,000, I remember that. And when the proposal was rejected, one of the reasons that they rejected it was because it was too cheap. So here we are. I didn't promise bells and whistles. That's the front, the main menu. very straightforward. The thing that is most important is database definition. This, we get back to the database theme here, is that databases are not something you just do, like a Google search or something like that. They have to be thought about. And the first thing you've got to think about is the purpose of them. So what I've done is just to prove that Strix did work on my old computer, I decided to define a database that, if I could get the information in, would work with the kind of data that I'm using now. And so I called it Metamon. Metamon is what I'm doing at the moment. And here it is, I hope. Yes. Now, my purpose is very straightforward with this stuff. I'm a content analyst, and from the process of content analysis, you can derive intelligence from an information source. And, you know, what I need to know, and I need to know the statistics, who is saying what to whom and when. All those pieces of information need to be collected, and so this is the field structure. Databases have fields. And I won't go into it all, but, you know, that covers my needs. A couple of points about it is I won't, you know, this is all the whole fields and word-by-word fields. Word-by-word fields means that every word is searchable. But one interesting little bit up there is that the plus and minus signs there is that each field can be password protected or not. Now, me as somebody who was a hopeful database or a wannabe database publisher, that was really important because you could give away bits and then get people to pay for the bits that were password protected. There it is. Minimalist input. That's all it is. Woe betide you if you made a mistake because the editor was not that good. There is another minimalist thing, which is the command line, the search. But if you look underneath, that list of green across the bottoms, very standard. Tony always thought of the user first, and that's the way the user. So look, if we went F2, commands for search, that's the list of commands, quite a lot. But the other thing was that contextual help was very much in his priorities. And so if you went F1, select help, all those things, you'd get the lowdown to what to do. Everything was there. Although I wrote the manual, it wasn't really needed. You know, it was all here. What I want to do is look at... through this. Look at combine. Let's do that. This is the most concentrated basic knowledge about text information retrieval and Boolean algebra anywhere, I believe, possibly in the universe, because, you know, he said it all in 2 pages. And so you've got the definitions. The thing, again, about sets, typical of Tony, was the right-hand rule. He reckoned that, you know, Boolean expressions, algebraic bracketed expressions, which is what people were using at the time, was too difficult for ordinary people. And so he just made the right-hand rule. So you do it and do it, and then on the right, it takes into consideration everything on the left. No brackets. You could also combine set numbers with the words you wanted, and Bob's your uncle, really. So that's what it, you know, it's fairly standard. It looks like that when you search. It's an and or not. I did a little bit of inputting, but only a tiny bit. This is what interested me most, and this gets a bit deep in a way. That is the search file. The search file, the way Strix works, and I think that Tony was one of the first people, he said he was not the person that invented the Boolean chop. Somebody else did, I don't know who. But the Boolean chop, as I'm sure you all know, is that if something is in the first half of an alphabet within a field, or in the second half, and then chop down until you get to this position. So if the data grows by two times, you've only got one more chop. And so unlike other databases, the bigger it got, didn't really appreciably slow down. And that was one of the big things. The other big thing about it as a database, compared with what was going on then, was that databases take a great deal of programming. Anybody like you that works in SQL and all those worlds know that it's a lot of hard work and that every search needs to be defined in some way and worked out in SQL. Well, what Tony claimed was that using this, you could have a database that people themselves could design and operate. Don't need programmers. Now, my own interest here is that, you know, I'm into sort of hierarchical stuff, and Tony had this hatted thing. We call the little hats there. And you could make, if you hatted the terms together when you were inputting, they would treat them as single words, but all the hatted ones together would also be a word. And so what this was doing for me was that I could, once I got my classifications in there, stricts in the search file would keep all the counts that I needed. The counts, who is saying what, to whom, how often, all that. And so, perfect, wonderful. Problem was that it was impossible for me to use, because who is going to put hats in and type it all out? Just too difficult. So what we did, while all this was going on, I had a company called Trend Monitor, and we did this all, continued doing it on paper. And we called Trend Monitor the Information Refinery. That kind of says it, what we were doing. There are some information refiners here who've come very kindly. And what we had was literally hundreds of publications that we would monitor. We would cut out all the articles that were important, and then we would classify them into files. And what we were is monitoring the flow of information through the classification system, so that you could see if you were talking about something at one time under the same classification. We did it quarterly. Trend Monitor was, I'll show you more in a minute, but Trend Monitor was quite well recognized, and like Tony and Mike Rebell, we managed to sell about 400 subscriptions at an average of a couple of hundred pounds each. We covered the areas of computing, communications, and media, and we kept this flow going through the physical files for 5 years, so that you would be able to compare back in time, like with like. And from that, you could begin to look at and talk about trends, both statistically and in terms of the content. We sold it for, the fatal flaw with Trend Monitor was that we were backed by ASLIB and worked very closely with ASLIB. Richard Coleman, I don't know, many of you would know Richard Coleman, but he was a great supporter. But the problem was that the better we got at it, the more we did, the bigger the books got every quarter. And this is what they look like. They're in a filing cabinet now, all there. A database, a snapshot of the dawn of the information age. 5 years. It's outside the internet. It's in my filing cabinet. I've always felt that was a bit of a pity. I don't know what can be done about it, but in some way, maybe they could be scanned in or something. And so, but that was the problem. All our money, in the end, went on printing. Well, most of it. And so the better we got at it, the more money we spent on the printing, and the less money was spent on us, the people who were doing the work, and we had to close it down, unfortunately. But the way it did work was that this is an example of computing. So a fairly standard hierarchy. We got hardware and software. Things to note that even back then, there were things called optical computers and molecular computers. And to just, you know, re-emphasize the point, if we had kept going, I would know now what was going on with optical computers, if anything. Don't know. But it would have gone in that box. And so, software, I called those subjects actors, things in the world. But then what we did was each of those was classified into another facet, completely different, which we called issues. And issues worked over those 5 years. I mean, all these things improve with time, but that was a particularly powerful thing. So you could ask our database would tell you what was being said about performance, for example, of mainframe computers, what was being said in one period, one quarter, compare it with what was being said in another quarter. And people found that pretty useful, I think. But the price got too high. The other thing that's quite interesting is that while we were monitoring computers, communications, and media, well, in about 1992, something like that, articles began to turn up, which wouldn't fit. They were part of what we were monitoring, but they didn't fit. And so, a content analyst, basically, if it doesn't fit, and our people will know this very well, you put it in a don't knows, and you let the don't knows build up. And then you go back and have a look at the don't knows, and what we came up with was socio-technologies. And so that then became part of the monitoring process and cost more money to print. But there it was. And so schemas evolve in that way. Going back to the beginning again, the very first thing, when I first met Tony, I was working on putting this book together, which was the first bit of, I'm a Canadian, I came over here for completely irrational reasons and got kind of stuck. And I thought, well, I've got to do something, and so let me do what I was doing in Canada. So I wrote this book, which is another snapshot, an even earlier snapshot. And I'm going to start using some of Tony's words now. So I'm going to read you his words. That is here. He could be, as many of you who knew him, he was such a generous character. And yet, as any master, master-student relationship. And, he could tease, and he didn't give praise easily. But when he gave it, by God, it meant something. And so, anyway, I'll just read a bit of this. I mean, the other thing I'll just pick out, he said in the foreword to this book, and very, very difficult to get Tony to write anything in English. Very difficult. He could write things in C, but so this is a great honor. And he said, it's old-fashioned and rather boring to talk about indexing and classification as a means of organizing access to information. And then after some lovely things that he said, I just want to read this one bit. In my close association with Jan Wiley, during the conception and preparation of the report, has convinced me that the techniques which have been used to derive the synthesis from the raw material are appropriate for use within computer and networking systems. Wow, we got there. Though the essential underlying research strategy has been that of content analysis, Jan Wiley has added a framework of classification and cross-referencing that is well-suited in computerized systems of information organization and analysis while remaining intelligible to ordinary people. We always wanted to be intelligible. And here is a little example of Tony being a I think you should read this. I won't read it out. Idiots and half-wits. He was very, very straight speaking. And this was something that when I was edited a magazine for ASLIB called The Intelligent Enterprise. And at the end of this article, he says, and I think this is relevant to what Susan is going to be presenting, and I'll try and read this. In conclusion, this was the same article right at the bottom. In conclusion, by all means, let us have some frank exchanges of views among experts. But let us make sure that we also ask the practitioners and users to tell us what they want and how they would like to get at it, especially with some degree of objectivity. Let us apply the procedures of science to the evaluation of the information art. He often used the term black art. Art and practice. No science there. And stop kidding ourselves that there is or ever will be a science of information, or even an information science. So that's where he was coming from, and I think that's what Susan is going to be talking about. There's an epilogue. I'm the epilogue, and my colleague Simon Eaton. I haven't given up. We still do pre-coordinate classification. I really do it now as I'm a forester now, but I do this late at night because it's addictive. And you know, once you know what you can know, it's very hard to stop yourself. And so I'm very simple at the moment. I'm using Firefox bookmarks, drag and drop. That's what we needed in Strix. And that's what we would have had if Tony hadn't died. We were in the process of putting it into Windows, into the world of drag and drop, and everything stopped. And it was awful. But I never really stopped the, you know, as Tony would have said, beavering away. And we're still beavering away, so I cover these areas now. And I believe that hierarchical classification and Boolean algebra is the way human minds naturally work. It's what I call the local loop from information to the mind. Once you've got a classification, a new layer of sense comes up. So here we have economy, markets. We'll go to the next screen. So that all opens up in that. I've got hundreds and hundreds under each of these categories. And by definition, they're not just relevant. They're pertinent, because I put them there. No computer. We don't have to justify any kind of search algorithm or anything. It is my opinion. But hell, I've been doing it, and it does work. So here we can see, okay, look, crisis and default. Now, I reckon people ought to know that one. And there's a lot like that. The idea, generally, was to, there's dynamite in all of these. But the idea was to use economy to fund what is my and Tony's greatest passion, which is the environment. And I won't go into, I can talk about this for hours, but I obviously won't. One of the rules of making these kinds of schemas, taxonomies, is that you have to use neutral, absolutely neutral language. And so, for example, under environmental change, impacts, life, that then subdivides into human and non-human. Now, non-human I used to call ecocide. Bad. That's pulling at people's heartstrings. No, it's just non-human. And so they, you know, for example, life also divides down into human, and all the awful things that climate environmental change does to human. But the biggest category, and this is another thing with what we do, is count, count, count. The biggest category is remediation. Massive. That then divides down into technology remediation, political remediation, et cetera, et cetera. That's what gives it meaning. So, as I say, I better not get stuck here because I could go on for too long. And I've got about 5 minutes left, I think. I have another person that I've been collaborating with, and that's Simon Eaton, who really, when Tony died, you know, it destroyed all our lives. And, you know, we've had to, somehow we got it back together again. And Simon Eaton, in a way, took up the mission, the database concept. And I can say that I now have a drag and drop database, which I can use 25 years later. Except Simon goes a lot further, because he thinks that, you know, well, he's talking about topologies. I mean, one thing is a database, and Tony used to say this too, database is useful and useless unless you know what's in it. It's not a thing that you can't search without some idea of what's there first. And so Simon is using Boolean algebra to make a visual record. And that diagram up there is actually a diagram that he's picked out about dark matter. Well, I think it's very appropriate because, you know, that unknown stuff is dark matter. And if you can get some kind of shape that you can manipulate, what I used to call in the old days hyperdimensional, but he calls data space, then you can have people engage actively, not be the passive recipients of something that is given to you because you've done a search and you don't really know how that works, but something that is created by yourself. Now, everybody tells me that, I know there are people from Google here, that the success of Google is absolutely necessary because people are too lazy to think. They don't want to think. They want it done for them. Well, Tony felt very strongly, as you come back here again, finding useful information is an intelligent process requiring intelligent people. Because at the end of the day, only the intelligent can recognize what is useful. So, fate had it that I ended up with the copyright of Strix. I also ended up with the source code. I've got runtime code as well. And shortly after he died, we all agreed that what we wanted to do was make that open source. That was a very long time ago, but the spirit didn't move us until now. But we've collected more or less everything together that we need, and I believe that there's some very, very good open source people here already. What we want to do is make this database, not information retrieval, a database with full-text information retrieval capabilities, as well as the ability to structure it, available forever to whoever wants to use it, and then develop into whatever it might become in the future. Don't know, but that's on the table. And so, in conclusion, you know, maybe the title of this, the ending of the speech, is quite appropriate, is 200th anniversary of Boole and the beginning of Boolean algebra. Maybe the Boolean universe has not been lost, but found again 200 years later. So I'm hoping that we can begin to develop this open source software into something real. Thank you.
Thank you, Jan, for a very stimulating talk. We have time for some questions before tea. We've got roving microphones. If you do have a question, put your hand up, but please don't talk until you get the microphone. And when you do, sort of hold it and talk into it like that. I'm just trying to switch this on. You on, Chris? On here first.
Hi, Andrew McFarlane from City University. Firstly, what license are you using for Strix? Secondly, do you have any plans to put it on the system on a source code repository like SourceForge or GitHub?
My answer to that is I don't know. That's one of the reasons I'm, you know, here to find out, because I'm a forester now. I'm out of touch. I monitor what I monitor, but it all sounds great. Yeah, wherever it ought to be, I'm willing to take advice. I don't know.
I'll give you my card.
Good.
Can I just ask, are you actually actively looking for people to collaborate on,
yes,
on
absolutely.
Doing this thing?
Right. Very much
okay.
So.
I mean, so there's
I don't
your
want
invitation.
To control it or anything like that. I just want to put it out there and for it to be picked up by the world.
So, Tony Russell-Rose from UX Labs. Could you just say a little bit more about what you had in mind, the vision of drag and drop for Boolean? What kind of things were you thinking about?
Well, let's go back to this. All that is drag and drop. Now, if I was going to try and get this kind of information into Strix, I'd have had to do a lot of typing. So a lot of it is done just in one hit. Very quick, very easy, takes a fraction of a second. If you know your schema or your taxonomy, bing, bing, bing. So speed is the most important thing.
Okay, so
ease and speed.
Can you hold the microphone to your mouth, please?
I mean, we're talking about pre-coordinate, yes?
Yeah, okay, yeah. So my in case people didn't hear, I was asking whether it was for the categorization of the data rather than for the articulation of the query, which was the other use case that I had in mind.
Well, the query is that once we have a database,
yeah.
Instead of just, it's pretty useless at the moment, in you get to denial, and then you've got a long list, and then you can subdivide that. But basically, in terms of a database, you'd be able to combine that with free text searching and to begin to develop underlying statistics as well. And that's what I'm hungry for. Because a content analyst in a database, once you've got those statistics, as I was saying before, you can see what the data is beginning to say. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Hello, my name is Maria Kingma. 33 years ago, in my first job back in the Netherlands, I remember our library using a program called Strix.
Of course, Fred van Bremen. Fred van Bremen was one of our great supporters and was...
Bremen, yes, exactly, van Bremen.
Yeah.
I used to work for the Council of State, and we had that program as one of the first catalog programs back
yeah.
then.
Yeah, I mean, we were all through the Netherlands government and very many Netherlands department, health, everything. Fred van Bremen did a great job.
Good. So, well, I'm glad to see you back after 33 years.
One down. Oh, okay.
Lee Picton, formerly Trend Monitor. When can we see the new visual Boolean system on the market or be able to get our hands on it?
Ask Simon. I don't know, but it's taken a long time. Simon, who writes the software, he's done it all by himself, and he's not very well, but he does persevere, and perseverance furthers. And as I say, I've now got it working on my computer. And to Now, one of the things is being stuck in the middle of Devon, working on a woodland. I don't get out to. I'm not interested in selling anything. Beyond that, I'm retired from trying to sell. I'm never any good at it, and now I just don't do it. And so, if somebody comes along and wants to take it up, great. I'm sure Simon. Simon is very, very. I'm not allowed to talk too much about it because, you know, he keeps his cards close to his chest. Because the visual part of it, if we show too much from his point of view, we've given away his crown jewels. So, you know, I don't know the answer, but I hope it won't be too long.
Hello. Have you looked at the Apache Lucene project? How does it compare with that?
I don't know anything about it. I know that Simon software runs on Apache.
Hello, I wonder if you could you remind us again what year Tony Kent was born? And I also wondered if he'd discussed with you his intention of setting up the Strix Award.
No, because he didn't expect to die at all.
The Strix Award was totally posthumous. It was after his death. Yes. So he knew nothing about it.
And Tony died, I think he must have been, he died in 1997,
yeah.
And I think he might have been 62 then, something like that. I don't really know. You saw the picture of him in 87 when he got married. I can't remember, but he died much, 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 much too young.
Yes. Yes.
My husband says he was born in 1933.
Okay.
My husband's got Parkinson's, so he finds him.
1933. Okay.
Yes, my husband, Dr. Ash Carby, worked with Tony Kent.
Did he?
And
Doug Hill.
And Doug Hill. And what year was he born?
Tony Kent, 1933, as far as I know.
Thank you.
Okay, Susan.
Are there any more questions? I have one. You were talking there about Tony being very much in favour of the human intelligence rather than machine intelligence. And there seems to be more and more emphasis on artificial intelligence and its growth. And I was reading something in the paper the other day about the growth of robotics and it's going to take over this, that and the other. I feel that's rather dangerous. Do you have a view on that?
My view is very much Tony's. And, you know, the problem with the way things are going is that it's taking away human agency, making people more irresponsible. They're not responsible for what knowledge they have. Google is responsible. And I do think that's very dangerous. And, you know, I wonder who benefits from that, from a populace that doesn't think. Does Tony believe that people should think and that the software should help them think? So I personally do think it's dangerous and very depressing.
Yeah, I look forward to the day when the first car crash occurs of a car being driven by a robot and somebody sues somebody.
Well, quite. I mean, absolutely. Who's responsible?
Yeah.
Nobody's responsible. So there it is. I go on about that for quite some time. Started writing about art. I had a category, artificial intelligence, in that 1984 one.
All right.
And, you know, we watched it then. And, in fact, probably many people know of Donald Mickey. And Donald Mickey was a great pioneer in that area. And I remember he once told me that it's much, much easier to send something to Mars than to actually get, we had milk floats then, to get a milk float to deliver milk. And so that's, you know, the milk float is a car. And they have done pretty good things to get it to do that, but anyway, I don't think we should get started on that one.
Right, are there any further questions? I don't know whether tea will be ready yet, because we're a little bit early. But we can break and you can have... Oh, there's one there.
Thank you very much. Charlie Hull from Flax, and we're open source guys, so I'll be talking to you later. This is a slightly left field question, but I noticed the logo on the manual, the Strix manual, reminded me of something, and I think it reminded me of something.
QR codes.
No, the BBC Micro. Did Acorn ever come and try and tell you off about that, or do you have a fight about who could use an owl in their logo?
They didn't, no. I think we might have predated them. Maybe we should talk to them.
Why not? Maybe they owe you some money. Fantastic.
Maybe they owe you some money for the project.
Any other questions or comments or anything? All right, well, let us break now for tea. Tea, as I mentioned, is in the lower library, which is just the room opposite there. You will have seen when you came in the notice telling you where the loos are, so you can have a comfort break, and we'll reassemble at... reassemble at 3:45 in here, please. Thank you. Good afternoon again, ladies and gentlemen. Am I on? Can you hear me? Hello, hello. Ah, this one works. Right, can we reassemble then and start off the next part of the meeting? And this is the main purpose of today, to hear the lecture by Susan Dumay, who of course won the Strix Award last year. I should just mention that we are privileged to have with us three other previous winners of the award. We have Stella Dexter Clark, who won it in 2006. We have Malcolm Jones, who won it in 2002. That's right at the back. And most impressively of all, we have the first ever winner of the award, Stephen Robertson, who won it in 1998. So with that, it's my pleasure to invite Susan to give us her talk on understanding and improving search using large-scale behavioural data.
Thank you very much for the introduction, and I'm delighted to have the opportunity to do the inaugural Strix lecture and to be in the presence of three other previous winners. So what I'd like to do today is talk about how large-scale behavioral data provides a very powerful and new lens onto understanding how people interact with especially web-based search systems. So over the last decade, the rise of web services has made it possible for us to gather traces of human behavior in situ and at a scale, speed, and fidelity that I think was previously unimaginable. And that's provided, I think, very unexpected and unique insights about what it is that people do when they're searching, and also enables us to dramatically improve web search engines. So what I'm going to do, using examples from web search today, is talk about how both observational data, what can we learn simply by observing how people use current systems, as well as experimental data that allows us to compare and contrast new alternative techniques, has really, I think, dramatically shifted, changed the landscape of web search. And I'll also talk about some of the limitations of such data. So, but before I do that, what I want to do is go back, not as long back as Jan did, but go back 20 years ago, before behavioral data was as prevalent as it is now. So if you think back 20 years ago, NCSA's first graphical browser was less than 2 years old. The first, what I call modern web search engines that used ranked retrieval and best match ranking, full text indexing and best match ranking, were less than a year old. Last night at dinner, Stephen pointed out that JumpStation, that was started in Scotland, I believe, had preceded this by a year, but it used sort of fairly standard just text matching without any best match ranking. But how these search systems, it's only 20 years since the advent of what we think of as the prevalent web search systems. I want to also show you what the online presence of some companies looked like, roughly 1995. This is the, how many folks recognize this? It's the UK Online Users Group, which I believe preceded the UK Electronic Information Group. This is actually quite sophisticated by, this was from 1999, so it's 4 years newer than this. This was Microsoft Research's homepage in 1997. It had imploding computers and people's heads, spewing off steam, not unlike the kind of processing that Jan showed to help make sense of large data. And it also features, of course, lovely New Times Roman. The size of the web 20 years ago was 2,700 websites. And when I say a website, I mean a top-level domain. The size of one of the earliest search engines, Lycos, when it debuted in, I think at the end of 1994, debuted with an index of 54,000 pages. And it didn't even index the full text of those pages. It indexed the first 128K because the whole copyright and intellectual property of web pages and indexing them with a fully inverted index and with positional information was unclear. So this is only 20 years ago. It also had something which looks quite quaint now. It says, check out the top 5% of websites. Okay. Now, if there are only 2,700 websites, that's 135 things. You can probably fit that on a page or two. So it was actually quite doable. And I still remember going to Mosaic and looking at new things that were appearing every day. What's more relevant to this talk is that behavioral laws were also pretty thin. Lycos got about 1,500 queries a day, I think in 1996 or 97. And this was a system that debuted at CMU with very technical sort of undergraduate audience. And the reason for this, of course, is that most logging of searches and even content was done client-side. So when I started at Microsoft in 1997, one of the first groups to visit me was the Windows Help team, Windows Help and Office Help. And any of you who search for technical information know what a challenge it can be to find that kind of information. So the first question I asked, and they believed that they had a problem with making the help system accessible to mere mortal users. I asked them, okay, well, what's the most common query? We don't know. What's wrong with the results? We don't know. And they were not perverse. They were not uninformed. All the indexing was done on the client, and all the retrieval was done on the client. They literally had no idea what people were searching for, making it very, very difficult to optimize the system. Starting in Windows 98, search was done as a web service, and all of a sudden, there were great insights about what people search for all sorts of information that there had been no help content created. You know, one example is how to convert from Windows 95 to Windows 98. Nobody had thought to write about that. They thought a lot about various esoteric things that the editors wanted, but they didn't have this insight into what end users were doing. And I think that's what I really want to focus on today, how understanding what's going on at scale can really help us not only provide better algorithms, but better experiences. So a lot has changed in the intervening decade. We now index a billion websites, so that would be a mere 50 million sites if I were to show you the top 5%. Trillions of web pages are indexed by web search engines. Billions of searches and clicks occur every day. And I'd say that search, at least in some guises, has become a core fabric of people's lives. It's been transformed from an arcane skill that was possessed by information scientists, like many of us in this room, into something that almost every internet user uses on a daily basis. Our parents use it, our children use it, and even my grandchildren use it. People use search for all sorts of things. They certainly use search to find information that's relevant to an ongoing project, to maybe an activity. It's also used to buy things, to plan travel, to understand new medical conditions that you might be diagnosed with, to monitor events. And so I think it's used incredibly broadly and in ways that we couldn't have anticipated even 20 years ago. It's also very pervasive. It doesn't happen just in web search, but you see search on the desktop and the enterprise and in apps. So I think now, more than ever before, it's really important to better understand what people are doing and to support them in being able to articulate what they're looking for, make sense of the results that come back, and so on. And I think behavioral logs are really an important new tool, which is why I want to talk about those today. So what do I mean by behavioral logs? To me, they are traces of human behavior seen through whatever sensors or lens you have. They could be how people interact with physical books. You've all opened a book that falls open to a particular place. That's an implicit interaction that people had that tells you how it was used. People often take explicit interactions by folding a corner. They highlight information. They might add marginalia in notes. Those are all indications of how people are interacting with these systems. In even a more physical world, we've all seen paths that people take, contrast with those that designers build. You can also see traces of user interaction in ways that are really quite ephemeral. These footsteps will be gone at the next tide. In the context of web search, the kinds of lenses we have are the queries that people issue, the results that are returned, the results that they click on, how long they spend. And so that's kind of the fodder that I'm going to use to describe some of the work that we've been doing. What's important about behavioral logs is that they're real-world behavior. Jan alluded to the fact that we need to understand how people use things, not just think about how they should use them in the ideal. These behavioral logs and traces are not recalled behavior. They're not subjective impressions. And they're not, importantly, controlled experimental tasks. So I think this provides a really interesting and important way of understanding search interaction. Here's an early example of one of my favorite uses of behavioral logs. This is a system developed in 1992 by Will Hill and Jim Holland and others. And on the left is a standard scroll bar. On the other panels are scroll bars that are annotated with user interaction. One of them shows the distribution of search results in a document. Another shows the read patterns that people have had, what portions of a document people have read. Another shows what portions of code people have edited. And so reflecting and enriching these objects with history of interaction, I think, is an interesting way in which behavioral logs can be used. A more modern example is a lovely system that Adam Forney did. Adam is a graduate student at Waterloo, and he's very interested in improving inter-application information set. So looking at how two applications that are used in conjunction can better inform each other. And search is used oftentimes to learn about feature-rich applications. And what he's done here is to integrate a before and after picture of an operation in a rich graphics editor in the search results. So if you search for, I forget what it is, it's selective colorization, you can see a before and after image of what that was. Okay. Behavioral logs are used to provide auto-completion. They're used to provide information about history of interaction. So they're used in a variety of ways. I want to situate behavioral logs in the context of a much larger set of experimental methods that we can use to understand user behavior. This is a gross oversimplification, so for behavioral scientists in the audience, bear with me. But I think it's a useful way of thinking about how we can understand what people are doing and seek to improve search systems. So there are lab studies. You can bring tens or hundreds of people into the lab, use carefully controlled tasks, look at how people engage with your favorite new system. One of the nice things about bringing stuff into the lab is that you can really use rich instrumentation. You could use eye gaze tracking. You could use think aloud protocols. And you can evaluate experimental systems that might not be ready for prime time. So there are a lot of reasons for using controlled lab studies, but they are one of many tools. Another set of tools that we tend to use are what I'll call panel studies. And here you can think about hundreds or thousands of people who use software in the wild, but typically with special client instrumentation that allows us to probe a little bit more deeply for behaviors that were surprising or interesting. So you can probe for the reasons that people took a specific action either at the time that it happens or later in interviews. And then there's large-scale log studies, which I'm going to focus on. Here, if you're running any major web service, you have millions of people and tasks. It's in the wild. One of the hallmarks that I'll highlight later is the tremendous diversity and dynamics of information seeking. Here you have an abundance of data, but it is noisy. It is unlabeled. And so I think a part of what we need to do is figure out how to make sense of that. Okay, now all of these different methods, whether it's a small scale lab study, a larger instrumented panel, or large scale log studies, can be used in two ways. One is you can simply observe what's going on. You can look at existing systems and see what people are doing, try to understand their information needs and their successes. This allows you to build an abstract picture of what people are doing. But in addition, all of these allow for careful, control, randomized experiments. We think of that oftentimes as associated with lab studies. But one of the ways in which search systems have advanced over the last decade or two is by doing carefully controlled laboratory studies at scale. So this allows you, these experiments allow you to decide whether one ranking algorithm is better than another, whether one presentation technique or spelling correction technique is better than another. And they're absolutely critical for advancing web search. I think when we think sort of in a canonical way, people think about lab studies being carefully controlled and log studies being something that you observe without being able to control them. And certainly if you look at a lot of the studies that involve Twitter data, most of the people who analyze that can only observe a system existing without knowing a lot about the metadata associated with the particular algorithms. But what I'm going to focus on today is large-scale log studies looking both at observational as well as experimental signals. So I'd say behavioral logs have three main benefits in my mind. One is that they're real world. They're a portrait of behavior, sort of warts and all. If you do a lab study, you very seldom get pornographic questions, but you see a lot of queries about that on the web. You very seldom get people repeating the same query, but again, you see a lot of that on the web. So you get a real-world portrait of what presumably we're interested in. They're large scale, millions of people and tasks. And so what this means is that rare behaviors are common. If I get a billion queries a day, something occurs one in a million times, I can still look at 1,000 instances of that in a day. Small differences can be measured. You can partition data in interesting ways. And one of the things that I'll highlight in the next slide is really the tremendous diversity that we see in web search behavior. It's also real time. You can get information about what's going on in the world very quickly. You just watch a stream of queries, you can know what events are happening in the world. Here's a case where you can detect the flu more quickly in web search queries than in the US, the Center for Disease Control. You can look at new things that have happened, like the Windows 10 launch or the recent plane issues in Egypt. So how, in many ways, it's astounding that one can go from a short query to anything at all sensible when you're indexing billions of pages. And I think behavioral logs are part of that. People talk about three generations of web search. The first is content-based, so you match a query to content on the page. And that is much more, that's very characteristic of a lot of the information retrieval systems that folks in the audience and myself have built. The web is also characterized by a very interesting set of link structure. So web pages point to each other. And this is often used to set non-uniform priors on pages, so not all pages have the same reputation or the same quality. And looking at the link structure can provide nice insight about that. But I think what I want to focus on here today is the fact that there's a lot of user behavior and behavioral interaction that can also inform the quality of modern web search engines. There's anchor text. When people point to somebody else's page, they use words to point to that. Those words can augment the author's description of what's on a page. People issue queries and click on results. That can inform you about what's relevant. Those queries are also an interesting way to augment the content that's provided on a page. People issue queries and reformulate them. It's a fabulous way to develop new spelling correction algorithms or to look at query reformulation patterns. And then there's a lot of contextual metadata as well about where queries are happening, who's issuing them, and so on. A lot of the important capabilities that you see in modern web search engines are driven by this prevalence of behavioral data. The uses of it, and I'll describe this a little more in a few minutes, range from improving the core ranking algorithms to enabling spelling correction and query reformulation to all sorts of interesting kinds of presentations. So I think this is one thing that's changed dramatically in the last decade or so, and it's really important to understand. So I want to go back about 20 years to talk about some of the early surprises in web search logs. I'm going to use data that was initially published by Craig Silverstein and later Andre Broder. But 20 years ago, web search was nascent. Our intuitions about web search came mostly from library search, right? And simply observing what people did was a real, say, eye-opening reality check. Web search was not library search. Queries were really short. Lots of people at that time searched for sex. Navigation was very common. People used search to get to web pages, not necessarily to find out about information. Queries were not independent. A lot of our retrieval models treat queries and documents as independent. That wasn't at all the case. And then there's this amazing diversity of information needs that has been called the long tail of information. And let me dig into that a little bit. I'm going to do it by illustrating what the long term of information needs look like using data that Doug Cutting made available from the Excite search engine, which was working in 1999, and I'm not sure if it made it into this century or not. But it was a log of time, a user hash, and then the query. Okay, so it was a log of 2.5 million queries, way more than the 1,500 that Mike Malden and the Lycos folks work with, but way less than the billions that we see in modern search engines. One interesting observation is that the most frequent 250 queries accounted for 10% of all the queries seen. If you're running a search service and you don't nail those 250 queries, you should have your head examined. Right? 250 queries can get you 100% satisfaction for 10% of your queries. At the other extreme, 950,000 queries occurred exactly once. It's almost 40% of the queries. If you look at larger logs, that number is more like 20 or 25%, but there's still a lot of queries that you've never seen before when you're running a web search engine. And these are distributed according to what's been called a ZIF distribution, where some things are issued very frequently and many are issued very infrequently. So here's an example. These are the top 10 queries in 1999 from Excite. So I'm looking at the head of that distribution. Okay, sex, Yahoo chat, horoscopes, Pokemon. It brings you back to some fun days only a little bit more than a decade ago. Most of these are either navigational queries or very short one-word queries. At the other extreme, these are queries that occurred exactly once in this 2.5 million queries. There are things about WinSock 1.1 Y2K compliance, UK millennial celebrations, all UK military museums misspelled. Okay, these tend to be, and misspellings are incredibly common. There are queries that are routinely misspelled more than they're correctly spelled. You know, Arnold Schwarzenegger, and I think Kardashian, and a few others. These are complex queries, rare information needs, and sometimes misspelling. And then in the middle, you can just see, again, the tremendous diversity of what it is that people are looking for. They're looking for antivirus software, cheat codes, email clip art, and a whole host of things. In general, these kinds of insights that are gained just by observing, I think, provide a lot of relevant information that we can use in designing experimental test beds and that we can use to generate hypotheses that we then bring into the lab, both in smaller lab studies as well as in larger studies. Queries vary tremendously over time and task. Here, there are periodicities, so in the wee morning hours, people search for porn more than anything else. In the middle of the day, it's finance, and in the evening, it's music and entertainment. You see trends like this all the time. So pizza, what day of the week do pizza requests peak? Saturday. Sunday is close second, but yes, on the weekend. You can see trends, like Tesla has become more common over time. Windows 10 has sort of a spike recently, so you can detect events as well. Understanding what's relevant to a query also varies over time. This example, you know, given the query ACM awards, what does that mean? If you're an information retrieval researcher or computer scientist in general, it might mean the Association for Computing Machinery. If I've just issued this as a previous query, it should give you good insight into what I might mean. On the other hand, if you've issued country music, it also stands for the Academy of Country Music. Okay? A lot of queries are incredibly ambiguous. You could use longer history, so if I ask a query, you can interpret it in one way, and if Garth Brooks with the cowboy hat asks it, you can interpret it in a different way. So let me just illustrate a few more things that you can gain by observing logs in the next few slides that I'll go through very, very quickly. These are fictitious cleaned up search logs from six different searchers. Okay, so you have the query, the time, and then a user ID. So one thing you can see is that there are a lot of what I'll call navigational queries. These are queries that are looking for a site, either the hotel or the Strix lecture, not information. You can see that some queries are more common than others. If you're running an operational search system, you better, again, be able to answer those. You better cache those results and do whatever you can to improve the experience for those. There are long-term information needs. User 142039 asks about information retrieval, behavioral log analysis, and does it for several days. There are also short-term tasks. Here's a user, a different user, who asked about the Strix lecture or the program or the registration. So you can see that there are different kinds of queries, long-term and short-term tasks and trends that are important. And these can be used in lots of ways to improve search engines. They can be used to improve the ranking, to improve system performance by caching and other means. They can be used to support history and presentation and so on. Again, I think these kinds of observations are really useful in helping us develop test sets that mirror real behavior rather than presumed behavior. And they're also important in setting up various kinds of larger scale, more formal studies. I don't have a ton of time. Let me just briefly mention that these web search logs are being used in all sorts of interesting ways, I think, to look at larger societal issues in addition to just improving web search. So in the US at least, 80% of adults search for medical information. About 1 in 250 people search for information about the top 100 prescription drugs. And so what Eric Horvitz and Ryan White have been doing over the last couple of years is mining health search data to identify adverse drug effects and drug interactions in a way that's very different than we can do today. So today, these kinds of interactions and adverse effects are detected based on reports from patients and clinicians. What Eric and Ryan did is they did a case study with the drugs paroxetine, which is an antidepressant, and pravastatin, which is a blood pressure drug. There was a report in 2001 that said the two of these seemed to be associated with hyperglycemia. So what Eric and Ryan did was they went back to pre-2001 search logs, looked at people who had queried for both of these drugs, and then looked to see the extent to which their logs showed an increased prevalence of use of terms associated with hyperglycemia, like thirsty and appetite increase and so on. And they found very strong effects. They were 10 times more likely in people who had issued both of these drug names in comparison with people who had issued only one of them. So I think this is very preliminary work, but I think it's also very exciting to think about how search logs can be used to increase the speed and scale of detecting things that right now are done in smaller scale and high latency environments. So I think the value of observational logs that I've described so far is really to provide insights about what people currently do to do this at scale, and really to provide the fodder for motivation for how we can improve search engines. And I think they also provide a potentially powerful lens for new kinds of scientific inquiry in medicine and a variety of social domains. What I've talked about so far is, again, observations. But in order to understand what really works, we need to do, I think, controlled experiments to understand whether ideas for new ranking algorithms, for new presentation techniques, even for things that we take for granted, query suggestions, are useful. And the way you do that is by generating or developing large-scale controlled laboratory studies in order to systematically control variance and to be able to compare in a more causal way the importance of different system variants. So these kinds of studies are conducted constantly by web search engines, by really anybody who runs a large-scale web service. And in the context of search, they're used to explore every imaginable thing that goes on into making a large-scale web search engine work. One is system latency. This example shows something like click-through rate. You know, time to first click is a function of how long page load latency is relative to what the standard is. Increasing page load latency by even 50 milliseconds causes all sorts of degradations in performance, whether it's time to click or abandonment and so on. But here you can carefully map out what the effects of that are, decide how much to address that versus a whole host of other things that you need to do in building a search engine. It's also used to evaluate ranking algorithms. New ranking algorithms are tested constantly. It's used to provide new ways of generating snippets and look at the effectiveness of those. It's used to support spelling and query suggestions. And it's used to support presentation of all kinds. And more search engines are moving from the proverbial 10 blue links to things that highlight entities, sort of moving from strings to things, if you will. And this is supported a lot by a large graph of objects, properties, and their relationships. So it's getting a little bit into the database realm where you have more sophistication than just a bag of words, if you will. But all of these decisions are made, Ronnie Kohavi talks about this in a wonderful analogy. So he describes this as moving from HIPPO-driven design to data-driven design, where HIPPO stands for the highest paid person's opinion. So in many of my early meetings, there would be people pounding on the desk to decide how things happened. Now, in addition, those insights really do matter, but more and more decisions are based on what happens, how people interact with the system. And so I think it really is an important new way of designing and evaluating systems. Conducting experiments at web scale is in some ways not all that different than doing so in a smaller laboratory environment. You clearly need to ask basic questions like, what do you want to evaluate? What metrics and measures are you going to use to evaluate? And it might not be just one. It might not be reaction time. It might be reaction time, number of queries, query reformulation rate, all sorts of things. Certainly at Bing, there are large boards that have scorecards of lots of different metrics, and I'm sure that the same is true with you, David. You can use within or between subject design, so you can give both the experimental manipulation and a control to the same person, or you can give them to different people. Within subject designs are actually amazingly nice if you can use them, because they minimize every source of variance between the experimental and treatment control, treatment settings. You're using the same people, the same queries, the same time, the same results. Whenever any of those vary, you're going to add a lot of variance and require a longer time to see any results. This is very useful for ranking these kinds of these kinds of within subject experiments, but it's much harder to use for many other kinds of design decisions. Some things are easier to study than others with controlled experiments. Algorithms, looking at the results, ranking is pretty straightforward. If you want to start introducing interface changes, you need to worry about whether people notice them, whether they make sense of them. If you're Facebook and want to understand how social systems happen, you need to make sure that there are not spillover effects from the treatment to the control groups. And then some of the things that are very different at web scale are you need to deal with a ramping up. So you start typically with a small number of people seeing something. If you're going to blow it, you blow it on a small scale. And it does matter. You worry a lot about experimental power and so on. So let me just summarize what I think of are the value of behavioral logs, and then talk about how we need to use complementary methods to overcome some of its limitations. So as I've said before, that behavioral logs provide, I think, often surprising insights about how people interact with existing systems, and they focus on supporting actual versus presumed activities. Carefully designed large-scale experimental settings can be used in many, many ways to improve systems, ranging from ranking to caching to algorithms and so on. And these kinds of behavioral logs, whether they come from observation or experiments, have really changed how people think about understanding searchers and improving systems. So that's the good side of logs. What are the limits? Well, logs are plentiful, but completely unannotated. They don't tell you what their intent was, whether they were successful, whether they were delighted or in despair. The same behavior can mean many things. If I don't click on something, does that mean I'm unhappy, or does it mean that I found the answer in the results? They're limited, and this is a really important thing, especially for behavioral scientists in the room. These kinds of observations are limited to existing systems and interaction techniques. They don't tell you how to design new systems. They provide evidence about what people are doing with existing systems. And there's still a lot of art as well as science in thinking about how to augment systems. Logs fundamentally tell us what people are doing, but not why they're doing it. Okay? And in order to address some of these broader issues, we need to complement behavioral logs that are incredibly valuable and are the lifeblood of many web services with other techniques, I'd say, to provide a more complete and actionable picture of how to understand and improve systems. And these include the laboratory panel and various kinds of predictive modeling as well. I'm going to now spend probably a minute each going through four examples of how we've built developed systems using these complementary methods, and then wrap up and have time for questions. So one of the first things we did about a decade ago now was to try to link these implicit and plentiful signals of what people are doing with explicit judgments of relevance and session success. So we had developed an instrumented browser, had our friends and family do it for some small rewards. And so we captured many implicit interactions. We probed for explicit judgments of both the relevance of an individual result as well as the success of a session. So there's a little browser plugin in that ancient browser. If you clicked on a web search result and then came back to the search page, we popped up a little dialogue that said, happy, okay, or thumbs down. Okay. It was also known as the annoying browser. But you could gate the frequency with which this appeared. People could turn it off for an hour or for a day. We also probed about results that they didn't click on, whether they knew about them before, whether they weren't successful. We probed about the success of a session. And so then what we did was we took these label data and the vast amount of implicit data and tried to develop models that would predict from the implicit data whether somebody was satisfied with a result, whether their session was successful, and so on. It turns out that if you use just the feature, did somebody click on a result to predict relevance, you do so with 45% accuracy. I said people click on things for lots of reasons. They are often misled by a very nice snippet. They often fail to find things if a snippet or summary is does not match onto their thinking. If you include things like how long you spend, whether you issue subsequent queries, how the session ends, and so on, you can get up to 75 or 80% accuracy, which is actually very useful now to monitor the health of systems, because you can use these models in an open loop environment to understand whether particular results are relevant and whether people are successful. Session success, we also developed predictive models for. This was incredibly highly correlated with whether a result in the session had been relevant. So highly correlated that it led us to believe that we had asked the wrong question. So people did, in fact, find things. What we should have asked them was whether they found things with a reasonable amount of effort, whether it matched their expectations. So we found out about success, but we should have probably asked about effort and delight. And as I said, we've used these to predict success. Another example that I'm going to run through quickly is search abandonment. So if somebody issues a query and doesn't click on anything, that's not very good, right? No, Stephen says. Well, it depends. So more and more web search engines are adding what we call inline answers, things like if you ask for the weather or conversion rates or even things about what the time is to cook baked potatoes, you get not just a big long list of results, but you get these answers. And in those cases, you're designing the system so that people don't click. Click would be not particularly helpful. So what we did in this case is we started with a retrospective survey. We asked people, the last time that you did not click, think back to the last time that you did a search and did not click on any result. Were you satisfied? Or were you not satisfied? And only 41% of the people were not satisfied. 32 were actually quite delighted. Many forgot what they were, got interrupted, never got back to the search. I mean, there are a lot of reasons for not clicking. And so we got a set of candidate reasons. We did another one of these in situ surveys, and then we were able to develop a predictive model for good versus bad abandonment. Another example of using complementary methods, melding observational logs with experiments, is some lovely work that Jamie Tivan and colleagues have done. When you think of web search, you often think about seeking new information, but in fact, a lot of what people do in search is refine old information. So 33% of the queries you issue in web searches, you've issued before. Look at Dave. What was the last query you issued today?
Oh, it was about this particular event. I think I must have issued it about 5 times.
Okay. And I suspect if you reflect back on some of your recent searches, there are probably things that you've done as well. 39% of the results that people click on, they've clicked on before. And now an awful lot of this repeat query, repeat click is what we call navigational queries, things like I type in Facebook and I want to go to facebook.com. You can also get hints about navigational queries using the anchor text that point to the page because they're very, very consistent in echoing the person's query in general. We also identified in this work what we call personal navigational queries. So these are queries that are whose interpretation is not consistent across individuals, but they are consistent within an individual. So if I type in ACM awards, I want the computing awards. If Garth Brooks types it, he wants the country music awards. And you might do it very consistently within individuals, but again, not across individuals. A very, very simple model of, I can almost reel out the code. If you issue a query and click on one result, you issue that same query and click on that same result again, you are 95% likely to do that, click on that same result the third time you issue the query. Okay? Very simple, you can write it in 10 or 12 lines of code, highly predictable and accurate. The benefits of doing things like moving up results that you've previously clicked on in this way to higher search positions was incredibly successful. It was one of the first examples that we tried of search personalization, although we and others do much more than that now. Okay, last example before I wrap up. Queries do not occur in isolation. 60% of search sessions contain multiple queries, and about half the time people spend searching occur in a very small number of sessions that last more than 30 minutes. Here's an example of somebody searching for shoes. It took almost an hour. They went to lots of different sites. They issued lots of variants. I'm sure they looked at lots of results. So we asked ourselves, can we do things to support this? We can certainly model queries in the context of your current short-term session activities, queries, clicks, reformulations. We can also incorporate information about longer-term preferences and interests. And indeed, when we do that, we can find improvements in how quickly people can accomplish tasks like this. But I was just talking to Dave earlier. I think one of the things that's still lacking, even in modern web search engines, is broader support for accomplishing rich tasks, complex tasks that try to make sense of the world. What you get, regardless of what task you're performing, is a list of 10 blue links, maybe augmented with entity information. I might spend a half hour today working, come back tomorrow, and what do I get? The same results that I got yesterday. We don't do anything to support people, and this is an area certainly of interest to me, really helping people accomplish tasks that take a lot of time that might continue across sessions and devices. So I think there's, although we can do some things to improve the ranking, I think there's still a lot of opportunity for improvement. So what I've tried to do today is to talk a little bit about the importance of a wide variety of methods, ranging from laboratory studies to panel to large-scale logs, in understanding what people are doing and also in improving systems to support them in doing that. I've talked about doing this both from an observational perspective as well as an experimental perspective, and I focused a lot on these large-scale logs because I think they provide an incredibly powerful and new tool that certainly I, as an information retrieval researcher, had not thought much about until the last decade or so. The behavioral logs, I think, uniquely, as I said earlier, are real world. They represent the kinds of natural distributions of tasks, searchers, and devices. They're large scale, conveying. I don't think there's any other technique that you can use to understand the tremendous diversity of queries, tasks, and searcher interaction that you see in the wild, and that they can also be very real time, immediately reflecting events in the world. So to summarize, I hope what I've done today in the short time I've had is to convey to you the importance and uniqueness of large-scale behavioral logs. We really do have an opportunity now to understand at a scale, speed, and fidelity that we've never had before what it is that people are doing with systems that we're developing and really using those insights to improve the systems. They've changed really fundamentally how at least web search systems are designed and evaluated and improved. Logs alone do not while they're wonderful, are not the complete picture, and they need to be clearly combined with ethnographic work, laboratory studies, and panels to give you a much broader picture. But I think that folks in this room, the computer science community, the information science community, should really lead the way in shaping not only best practices, but policy in using behavioral log studies to inform not just the design of web search engines, but a lot of other web-based services. So thank you for your attention. Lots more information here, and I'd like to thank many of my collaborators who've been a big part of this work. Thanks for your attention. Time for a few questions?
Yeah. Okay. All right, so now we have time for some questions. Just remind you, please don't talk until you get the microphone, and talk into the end of the microphone when you get it.
Oh no, I'm going to get a hard question, I can tell.
Stephen Robertson, if you consider the 20 years that you've been talking about, the web search engines, Bing and Google and all the rest, mm-hmm. have learnt in the way that you've discussed from users a great deal.
Right.
At the same time, the users have been learning from the search engines.
That's right.
So just for example, at the beginning of search engines, there was no spelling correction.
Right.
It was discovered that many people were making spelling errors and typographical errors, therefore you needed to introduce spelling correction. So now it's done extensively. Right. So now I don't care if I make typos. So I've learnt that I can right. search in a different way than I did 20 mm-hmm. years ago. Mm-hmm. And a gazillion people have done that.
Right.
I just wondered that this sort of feedback process is quite interesting. Mm-hmm. I mean, again, we've learned that we can do complex searches with 2.4 words, right. or 3 or 5, but
it's 5 is exceptional. It's up to 3
or so now. Yeah, yes, yes. So I just want for your comment.
Yes,
comments
I think
on that.
That's a great question, and you're absolutely right that there is kind of a co-evolution always of technology and people's behaviors. Another example, and part of the reason why people didn't ask long, complex queries 2 decades ago may well be that they tried, and the results were appalling, right? And now I think you see some of that kind of longer queries that are expressed in more natural language that indicate metadata that might be of interest when people are doing spoken queries on the phone. So the kinds of people are now speaking queries, those look pretty different than what you get in a desktop web search engine. The results are, I would say, delightful for some set of queries, and there is an uncanny valley for many of the others where the results are really bad. But I think there again, you're starting to see web search engines evolve into understanding richer syntactic and semantic information as well as spoken vocabulary. So I think we will see that. One of the challenges, of course, in focusing on systems that exist and trying to improve them is that you sometimes tie people's hands behind their back. And so I think we need to continue to understand what kinds of things people aren't doing on search engines, where it takes way longer than it should. And I think with all of that, we can develop systems that will continue to delight moving forward.
Andrew McFarlane from City University. Following on from what Steve said there about spelling mistakes. Mm-hmm. One of the things that I think that in the community we don't do well is deal with disabilities in general, cognitive disabilities in particular. Mm-hmm. I focus on one, dyslexia. Yeah. Now, one of the key things that dyslexics do, obviously, is make spelling mistakes. Mm-hmm. So, you know, by eliminating spelling mistakes, you might actually be eliminating some important information to help that particular user group. That's mm-hmm. There's also things to do with click-throughs, which I have some ideas about, but I'm not fully formed yet. I know this is reading up to the basic question is, how can we help this particular group of people on web search that we're not, in my view, helping as much as we should do?
That's a hard question. I don't work very much on... I do work a fair amount on personalization, which tries to improve search, but typically relevance and presentation for different individuals. Mary Morris and Ed Kuchel are working a lot on, I think what's called cognitive neurodiversity of people, trying to understand different ways, spelling errors are one, but other kinds of reasoning and cognitive errors are others. When you said we throw away spelling errors, we don't. I mean, the system knows that there were spelling errors and that they were corrected. So one could still use that. Eugene Agerstein has been looking at how people, whether one can tell from search and other kinds of interactive behavior about early evidence of some other kinds of cognitive and physical limits. So I think there are ways we can do it. I've been doing work in eye gaze tracking where, again, you can get signs of confusion. So when people read, they typically move in a pattern where there are a series of ballistic saccades. When they're confused, they tend to revert to previous words. And so, you know, with the, you can certainly tell about some of those kinds of confusions and hopefully accommodate them. So I think one aspect of your question is diagnosing those, and that I think we can do. How you accommodate it is a lot less clear to me. But I think we are starting to, there's certainly interesting things we can do in that direction. It's not a main focus of my work, but there are certainly folks at Microsoft Research who are looking at that. I think you had a question, did you not? Yes, didn't you have your hand up earlier?
Thank you. My name is Peter Vickers. I was wondering about 50,000 different things I would like to ask you, but I'm also regretting that I retired 20 years ago. I wish I was in the game now. But no, it seemed to me, with all respect, that much of what you were saying to refer to users as though they were all people, whereas, of course, people vary a lot depending
on
their age and their background.
Yes. Yes.
To what extent does your work allow you to look at that sort of variation in the responses that you get, not all responses, the data that you collect? You take it all in, whether it's 3-year-olds or 80-year-olds, you know?
That's a great question. A lot of the work that's done, certainly in web services, is aimed at serving the aggregate. But focusing on providing a single ranking for every person at every point in time, regardless of what they've done in the current session or over a longer period of time, fundamentally limits how well search engines can do. And I think I gave Doug 2 options for a talk, and that was the second one. So I'm really passionate about personalization. And I think we can do a lot, ranging from very simple things like that personal navigation, where interpreting a query that I have responded to it in a particular way over and over and over again. If you don't accommodate to that, you're crazy. There's just perfect evidence to do it. But there are all sorts of other ways in which we can personalize results. People on a mobile device are probably better served by different results and certainly different presentation than on a desktop. We've looked at things as different as readability of pages and you can return different pages for folks with different reading ability or children or different experience, domain expertise. And so it's a huge part of what we do and one that's very difficult to evaluate, but one that we try hard to improve. Whoa.
Hello, thank you for that lovely talk. This is Stella Dextre-Clark. And you ended by reminding us that analysis of the data that you collect can be used not just for improving the search process, mm-hmm. but for loads of other things. And one can imagine that it would be interesting to the authorities for detecting things that are going along in the public and anticipating the threat, say the flu epidemic and doing something. Or it could be by commercial websites, you know, how to improve their web page or their product, you know, to mm-hmm. sell more. or by bad guys, you know, finding out about what citizens are doing and setting up a bomb or who knows what. Now, obviously you can't address all these, but by what mechanism could or should the people other than you collecting this, the people out there, can they make use of things to make the world a better place?
It's a great and complex question. I mean, certainly anybody who runs a web service of any sort needs to abide by their terms of service, which are typically to improve their product and services. We're all very careful of user privacy and storing logs in ways that protects that. But in the aggregate, I think there are some kinds of things that we can do to look at trends and share those with the public and medical community.
Sometime.
Yeah.
That was a great talk, Susan. My question deals with personalization, and I go back to my dissertation, actually, when one of my participants said, if you only give me what I want, then I'll be a very boring person. And this was a carpenter, which surprised me at the time, but has stayed with me ever since. And so now I wonder if it's about personalization for individuals or personalization for the task, or if there's actually a tension between the two, and when do you deliver what?
Right. So I guess when I use the word personalization, I mean probably... we should probably have used the word contextualization. So it could be for an individual, it could be for an aggregate who share, people in this room might mean different things when they type in Susan Dumais than others. It might be a geography. So I do mean a breadth of those. I know that people worry a lot about the so-called filter bubble when you personalize. We've done some thinking about that. We've done some experiments looking at not just the relevance and pertinence of results, but also whether they're interesting to people. And it turns out that when you personalize, not only do you find more relevant results and useful results, but you also find more interesting results. And so I think part of the reason for that is people, when they talk about serendipity and so on, don't want to be surprised by random things. You need some scaffolding by which to hang those. And so I think part of what personalization does is provide that. On a somewhat more pragmatic note, when we do a lot of the personalization that we do involves re-ranking the top K results, and so there I think we're and potentially optimizing search results to include diversity rather than just sort of a single intention. So I'm less worried than some about the potential filter bubble. I think a recent Facebook study suggested that there was more of a bubble created by the friends that you follow on Facebook than by any of the algorithms. So I think it is a concern, but...
Jan, why? It's picking up a little bit on the question over there about serendipity and how you account for that. And I'll tell another very brief story, Tony. Sure. Was a mischievous individual, and one of the things that he used to do with the chem abs is he randomly threw in completely irrelevant results.
That's great.
And he found that people liked the irrelevant results better than the ones that they were actually looking for.
Okay. Well, I think it was great to throw in random results because that gives you at least... a kind of experiment and one that you can learn from. I guess I would doubt that in the aggregate people would prefer random results than ones that match their content, but I can certainly imagine some of them being quite delightful.
How do you account for serendipitous behavior? I'm just sort of surfing the net, don't know what I want.
Right.
And one thing leads me to another. I think possibly quite a lot of people do that.
That's right.
Yeah.
So two thoughts about that. One is one can certainly introduce diversity in what's returned. We tend to think of a couple types of diversity. One is what we call extrinsic diversity. So there are really different intents behind a query, sort of like ACM awards. And the other is intrinsic diversity. Even if you nail the entity or object that I'm interested in, there are lots of different aspects of it. And I think search results can certainly be broadened to include those different kinds of diversity. And the other is that if you combine search with many other techniques like navigation, so it could be structured data, it could be other kinds of grouping of results, I think that does encourage people to not just focus on what they asked about, but generalizations and specializations of that. So I think there are things one can do both in the interface and on the algorithmic side to help support some of that. But creativity, serendipity, all those things I think are very important, but hard to operationalize concepts.
I'm Dave Harper, Google. Most academic researchers don't have access, clearly, to the search logs of users. To what extent do you think that limits the impact of research that can be done? And to what extent is it tying their hands so much behind their back that you know, maybe the academic community should give up on doing research in web search? Now, I'm being a little controversial, but I'm just interested in your take on this.
Sure. So I focused on large-scale logs. I was just talking to a student of M&A's during the break who asked a similar question. I think whatever system you design, you need to understand how people are using it. A lot of the examples I gave were done without necessarily having a huge web search engine. So the Curious Browser work was done with a couple thousand people. We sent out floppy disks at the time to collect that data. I think we need to think really broadly about methods. Even web search engines that have terabytes or petabytes of logs per day still need to probe users to understand some of the what behind the why behind the what. And so I think everybody needs to use complementary methods. If somebody is interested in improving operational web scale search engines, there are aspects of that that can be done in a university, but there are internships at various web search companies, and I think that's probably the way to do that. I'm not going to mention names.
Hi, Charlie Hull from Flax. We work generally on things like site search or enterprise search.
Yep.
And again, it's following on what you just said there. How many of these methods do you think are transferable to those different domains where generally we've got a lot less volume in terms of queries, we've got collecting logs is more difficult sometimes, and we're also looking at methods such as explicit judgments by experts, by content experts.
Right. Microsoft also has many enterprise search systems that I, as well as desktop search, that I continue to be interested in and try to improve. So I think you clearly do not get the volume of queries that you get in web search engines, but I certainly know that in the Microsoft Enterprise, there are queries that appear with non-uniform probabilities. There are queries that appear with various kinds of periodicities and trends, and it is important to log and understand those. I think one of the really big challenges in enterprise search is, at some level, web search is really easy because although you have tons of engineers trying to optimize, in some sense, a single service, in the enterprise, you're dealing with not only heterogeneous content, but different kinds of heterogeneous content at different companies, different attributes that matter in ranking. So maybe we use a lot of SharePoint sites, and those have incredibly high priors of importance, and another company doesn't. And so I think the fact that there are, it's hard to tune a web search engine whose parameters will apply broadly. It almost has to be self-tuning and self-learning. So you're right, there is less data. I think you should look at it, and I think look at it to understand successes, failures, and the hard challenge to me in enterprise search is simply that the same set of parameters is unlikely to work at different installations. I think we can aim toward tuning those dynamically.
Phil Coley. Jan earlier on in his thing talked about Tony Kent and the lost vision of a Boolean universe.
Right.
First of all, congratulations to Google for celebrating George Ball's birthday a few years, 2 days ago. But regardless, in terms of log searches, do we find anybody still using?
Absolutely. There was one in my example 20 years ago.
20 years ago, I was using them.
You see them. So this, I think, gets back to Stephen's question. People will use Booleans when results are not in accord with what they expect. And I think web search engines have done a pretty amazing job of using soft ands and importantly priors on different sites and tend to satisfy those. So there are, you certainly see advanced operators. I don't know off the top of my head how many you see. You also see plus and minus and quotes, which are, so the pluses and minuses are a simple kind of Boolean. The quotes are like your carrots to provide more syntactic information. So I think there still is some of it.
Hello, Paul Matthews from the University of the West of England in Bristol. I was just wondering about the fact that, you know, most people Googled how to get here or
Binged how to get here.
And I mean, a lot of searches are predictable because you've got to get somewhere. You're going to have to look up how to get there,
right,
how to get into this building, where the front door to this building is, all that kind of thing.
That was the hard bit, yeah.
So do you think there's going to be a sort of resurgence of intelligent agents that actually help you in a kind of predictive way, so it kind of gets rid of the need to do all these searches and get more confused than you were to start off with?
Right, more confused than you were. I think that, let me respond to a couple aspects of that. So the first is that you highlight that there's a tremendous variety in what people use search engines for. A lot of it is not what librarians or information professionals would have called sort of serious search. But people are using search engines to get to web pages, to find out simple factoid things like where is this, what's the address, what time is it, what's the weather. You can go outside the door and look, but people search for that sort of stuff. So and people also search for hours on end about new medical conditions and alternative treatments. So there's a wide, wide variety of what it is that people search for. I think we are seeing with various services, sort of Cortana and Google Now, search systems being more proactive based on typically on location, but you can imagine it being based on a series of queries that I've issued. And I think that kind of proactive stuff is really interesting and will be a nice complement to some of the more explicit searches. So I think we do see some trends in that direction.
Yeah. Stefan Rüger from the Open University in the UK. So I've got a nice anecdote about different kinds of why people search. So whenever I'm unsure about an internet connection, I search with a one-letter search.
T is my letter to check.
Mine is H. And I was incredibly disappointed when no longer Planck's constant appears as the top search result. And recently, when I spent some time in New Zealand to work with Ian Witten, H actually brought up Ian H. Witten as the third result, which was a nice little anecdote for that. But one thing that disappoints...
Spam.
Well, it was google.nz, so that's... That's perhaps why Ian's name came up in the top 10 list. But that brings me to my question. Mm-hmm. So I used to be able to ask, give people some information about a document by saying, well, use this search engine, type that query, and you'll find it in the top five. With personalization, that's no longer going to happen because all of a sudden the ACM awards will mean something different for me to someone else. So what do people do about that?
There's certainly some truth to that. I don't know how common it is to share a query and say you'll find it in the top few results. If it's somebody who's like you, then that's likely to work. There is a lot of variability that I think is people don't experience in what's returned for the same query. If you issue the same query five times in the next hour, And it's not a query that's cached, you're going to see a fair amount of variability in what's returned, because new content's being created. When you're running a system where millions of machines are used as input, one of them may be down, so things might not be available. So I think there is already a lot of variability in web search systems. We developed a system at one point called DiffIE that highlighted when you visited the same web page what changes had occurred since your last visit. And that's how I know a lot about the variability in web search, because you see it when you visit the same page. I think we just have to balance variability and consistency with a broad set of information needs. If you're monitoring an event, you probably want to know what's different in that event, even though an important result came up higher last time. So again, it's one of these trade-offs. There may be some cases where consistent results are important. Search engines very seldom drop really important navigational queries from the top of results, but there is certainly variability below that.
Elaine Toms, University of Sheffield. I wonder what the responsibility of search engines are regarding quality. So now we've added snippets, which are some abbreviated content. We're getting into whatever you call them, e-cards with more information about the item.
Yeah.
But where's the responsibility for accuracy and reliability? I was at a meeting a couple of weeks ago when one of the speakers said, if my clients don't get the right document, our organization could be fined millions of pounds by the government.
Mm-hmm.
So there's an onus on the search engine software to be able to deliver the right stuff. But is there an onus on web search engines to do the same thing?
Sorry, yeah.
An onus on web search engines. So does Bing have any responsibility? Is there any work being done to look at authority of the source and accuracy of the content?
I think the accuracy of the content is something that search engines are not going to deal with. They don't provide the content. You might be able to. So I actually gave a talk at Waterloo recently, and I did a query on University of Waterloo, and the answer pane in both Google and Bing returned the wrong answer for the chancellor of the university because it had not been updated on the Wikipedia page. But it at the same time returned search results that had a new chancellor has just been named or has just taken office. So that's a case where you might detect a bit of a mismatch. But in terms of the underlying content, I find it hard to see how search engines could be responsible for that. You certainly can get a sense based on click-through, people visiting different sites, the extent to which people are satisfied with particular domains and information sources. I mean, that is a concern, but the content of individual pages, I think, is just something that would be much, much harder to deal with.
So why don't you have a warning or a buyer beware? That no search engines suggest that in the same way that other products, for example, that we purchase, cars or foods, for example. You're providing information as just another product.
I'm not sure what you're asking about. So you want at the top of everything, searcher beware?
You should be able to say that.
Okay, I'll repeat it.
You should be able to say that this particular site, we know that from past experience or long-term use, this particular site provides an authoritative source of information on medical information, for example, or products for purchase.
Mm-hmm.
Take your pick of possibilities.
Right. That's not done with explicit metadata. It's done implicitly, I'd say, through ranking and also through the use of some trusted resources to provide the fodder for some of the entities. It's not done explicitly, and maybe it should be.
I thought that Google Graph and semantic search were supposedly aimed at doing that. They talk about it, and I don't know how it works, but is it reasonable that veracity is something that a search engine can deal with? But they are claiming it, if I'm not mistaken.
I don't know that I can speak for the Google Graph. And a lot of a lot of content in these graphs is derived from structured sources, and those might or might not be right. You can certainly, when you're integrating information from many sources, identify discrepancies, and that may be a sort of a red flag or a pink flag that says, hey, lots of different answers for, and the right answer changes over time. You know, who is the current president of the United States? That's going to be different in, you know, in a few months than it is now. What country has the largest GDP? That changes over time. And so I think there are, time is an important dimension, certainly the quality of relationships and amongst entities is an important one, but one that I guess I can imagine saying we think this is the best answer and this is the relationship. It's you know, it's not a structured database, it's an inferred knowledge base, as far as I know.
I'm sorry if it runs over time, but I had a quick question about your complex tasks slide, where you said that when people are doing things that take longer period of time, they have to start like right at the beginning because there's no way of showing or logging, or the user has no way of seeing what he did in the past.
Right.
What would be your insights about if we were to study that? How to enable users with their history? How would you go about suggesting doing it?
But there are certainly several research prototypes that have been built to show you a history of queries that you've issued, results that you've clicked on for a particular task. Most of those systems have the characteristic that they're yet another place to go to. So I think you need to figure out how to integrate some of this support into the places like web search engines that people naturally go to. If I were to populate it, it would show related searches, what you clicked on, potentially what's changed in some of those sources since you've looked at it. I think there are lots of ways it can be done.
But you would say that it has to go with the search results as well? I would be sitting outside even before you open the browser, just somehow the first pages, this is your past history without...
Oh, well, you can do that. I mean, all web search engines have a history and you could seed your homepage with that history.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I'm saying more than that because a lot of times people are interleaving tasks, and what I might want to do is pull out research that I'm doing for this talk from research that I'm doing on eye gaze tracking. And to do that, I think requires some explicit structuring from the user, or at least inferred tasks from a search engine. I don't think it might be. It actually is interesting to see what you've looked at and what things you look at frequently. But I think if I were to support a long task, I'd want to group it by that task in some way.
Thank you.
Time for maybe one more question. Can I ask a detailed one?
Sure. A detailed one, okay.
Yeah. And it was something you said, I think, when you were talking about your annoying browser.
Okay.
And you said, could you say, you found that if somebody clicks on a website, it predicts the relevance with 45% accuracy or something
correct.
I thought relevance was something, a characteristic of the user. If I'm the searcher, I know what's relevant and what's not.
Right, but so...
But also... Things don't tend to be black and white. It's not. It's either 100% relevant or 100%
sure.
not. It's sort of relevant somewhere on a 0 to 100 scale.
Right. So, first of all, in that experiment, the people who made the judgments of relevance on a 3-point scale, not a much finer scale, were the actual searcher right after they had made it. So what I'm saying in that case is that if somebody clicks on a result, only 45% of the time did they believe that result was relevant to them at this moment in time. And I don't remember whether we counted partially relevant in the relevant bucket for predictive purposes, but you're right that relevance is incredibly contextual and personal. And in that study, at least, we tried to do. There are lots of reasons why you click on things that don't turn out to be relevant.
Sorry, just another thing that a Tony. Hobby horse, if you like, and it might be helpful. He always distinguished between relevance, which was a relatively useless thing because what isn't relevant? I mean, what you're wearing might be relevant, but he used the word pertinence,
right.
And that's all I wanted to say.
Yeah. We've had people, that's important. We've had people judge relevance. There's usefulness, which may be closer to pertinence, and interestingness, which is yet another dimension. There are lots of reasons why things might be interesting to look at. But you're absolutely right. The relevance is, yeah. Okay.
Okay, well, let us all thank Susan again. I think she's very interesting too. Susan said time was important, and it is, and we're running out of it. One of the interesting things that came out of Susan's talk was user 142039 or somebody searched for information about this meeting and about sex clubs. So if user 142039 is in the room, will you please identify yourself, and when you go, can I come with you? So we said this was the first Strix lecture. And it's got us off, I think, to an excellent start. Thanks to the generosity of Google, we do hope to continue this. And so next year, this year's winner, Professor Peter Ingwersen, has already agreed that he will give the Strix lecture. We don't have a title and we don't have a date yet, but it will be widely publicised when we do. So do keep your eyes and ears open for that. And we hope to see as many of you as possible back again, probably here, about this time next year, for the second Strix lecture. Thank you.
Yeah.